Hello everyone, this is Aegon of Astora, and welcome back to Bloodborne Let's Talk Lore. This is episode 22, being recorded on Thursday, March the 3rd, 2016. I hope you're all having a fantastic day today, whenever it is you find yourself watching this. So this is, of course, where we left off last time. The Lumen Flower Gardens, and I'm not sure I have much to say myself about this area. We do have some comments that I'll try to get to, that speak to the significance of the Lumen Flower Gardens and how and whether it differs from the Lumen Wood Gardens. But yeah, this window right here can be very easy to miss. It's very easy to miss Ibritas and the... Altar of Despair. Sorry, I forgot the name there for a second. During my blind playthrough, the only reason I figured it out, I'm not sure if I would have figured it out otherwise, but when during the boss fight with the Celestial Emissary, you can actually see the glass clipping through the fog gate. So that indicated to me that there might have been something there. But this does raise another question, and that is... Or I suppose not really a question, but it seems to indicate, of course, that Ibritas is being hidden from anyone who might otherwise be here. Like, this whole area is hidden, of course, because you wouldn't want just normal Yharnamite to stumble upon this place either. But... The Altar of Despair is hidden times two, because, yeah, there doesn't seem to be any easy entrance. And this Celestial Child, consistent with the ones that we saw in the lower portion of the Upper Cathedral Ward, is facing in the direction of Ibritas. So down there, of course, we can see the Grand Cathedral. You can kind of see the lamp there. Based on the distance, we are seeing lower quality textures and lower quality model of the area. And in fact, it doesn't look like you can see the amygdalas lining the stairs there. So that's something that's kind of disappointing. I'm interested to see to what extent that is also true in Dark Souls 3, which I imagine it will be. Call Beyond, and this corpse here is just a standard Healing Church corpse. Corpse model, I should say. Which I imagine would also include the choir, so this would seem to be a member of the choir. A Call Beyond, one of the secret rites of the choir. Long ago, the Healing Church used phantasms to reach a lofty plane of darkness, but failed to make contact with the outer reaches of the cosmos. The rite failed to achieve its intended purpose, but instead created a small exploding star, now a powerful part of the choir's arsenal. At times, failure is the mother of invention. So, certainly won't be of much use to us in this boss fight coming up, but it's still pretty cool. This elevator here was bugged in the early versions of the game, so another point in favor of always remembering to send an elevator back up after you're done using it is that I believe in the first or the second version of the game that was released, the unpatched version, if you sent this elevator back down and you didn't send it back up, you would be SOL, shit out of luck, because the lever here wouldn't work as it ordinarily does to send the elevator back up. So let's see if these celestial children, yep, they are all facing Ibritas. So every single one we find is facing Ibritas. As that post made by Allison indicated in that we discussed in the previous episode. So this is, I think, yeah, Damien of Mensis. And I'm considering whether or not I should summon him. And something I never actually noticed is that you can see this messenger in the middle of here. He's actually holding the old hunter spell. That's pretty cool. That's a nice touch. Or I suppose the messenger in the front, because there are actually four of them. Because I am thinking, I do think that when we go to Yharghal, I do want to summon Defector Antel, because I think we do need to talk about who he is, and, you know, from whom and to whom did he defect. It's something that, yeah, we should all think about. But yeah, I think we'll leave Damien. I believe he wears, or maybe we'll summon him just to see what he's wearing. And then we'll send him back. So he's wearing the student uniform, the variant with the cape. He has the lock shield and a Mensis cage. He has a very blank stare. I suppose that's true of pretty much all of the NPCs in Bloodborne, but maybe it's just the Mensis cage that gives that look. But you can see he's pretty old. And also interesting that he would be here. We also find him, I believe, in Bergenworth, right next to the door before you go onto the balcony to meet Master Willem. But it's curious that he would be here. So perhaps much like Edgar, who we'll be talking about soon in an upcoming episode, much like Edgar, he's engaged in espionage, I guess. Because the School of Mensis and the choir do not have the most amicable of relationships. So there's something going on there. Alright, see you later, Damien. So the Altar of Despair. So this is a place we spent a good 5 or 10 minutes talking about during our pacifist community run, which we live streamed. I think that was during the Christmas break. This semester has been a whirlwind for me because it's been so crazy. There's been so much stuff going on. So my memory right now, I'm just getting over a bug that I've had, and so I haven't been feeling especially well. So you'll have to forgive my lack of memory for the moment, but I do recall us talking about this place a fair bit. That is really creepy, and I can't tell if it's just the low quality texture, or if it's that elsewhere we don't actually see the faces on these things, that they're shrouded. But these ones we do. We see a lot of their faces. And they do look... This face right here, where my crosshairs are, it does look a little bit like the Thumerian descendant. They have that really just the way they open their mouths like that. It's kind of circular. I don't know if I'm just seeing that because I want to see that, but it certainly does. So we don't see these statues anywhere else in the game, to my knowledge. And that's the first time I've noticed that. Because recall that throughout most of the rest of the game, these statues have... all their faces are shrouded. They're covered. But these ones, yeah, you can actually see the faces. And the circular mouths they have. These things here look a great deal like the fishmen. Or at the very least, like the statues that are meant to represent the fishmen or something else from the fishing hamlet. So there's a lot to talk about here, but as I mentioned, yeah, during my pacifist, during our pacifist community run, when we came here, we spent a bit of time talking about it while Ghost Hardware actually soloed Ibertas for us. But when we entered the boss room, I made Ghost Hardware wait as I blabbed on and on about this place. Because it's extremely interesting, not only because of Ibertas, but because it seems to be... This seems to be a part of the old underground labyrinth. This does not appear to be part of, like, it's still part of Yharnam in that it's in the city of Yharnam. But this place is unlike any other place that we go to in the game, except for maybe the cave in between Yosefka's clinic and the Forbidden Woods. And another piece of evidence in support of that, just like in that cave, we have here what appears very much to be level 5 tomb mold. Material used in a holy chalice ritual, mold that grows from rotten flesh and blood inside the old labyrinth, matures to bear giant spores. And you'll recall in the previous episode I also pointed out that those spores create a very cosmos-like effect. And though we don't really see it in the air here, that certainly does look a fair bit like the level 5 tomb mold. We also have a corpse of what appears to be Rom, or a Rom-like creature here. And Ibertas herself. Which, in the previous episode, we talked a little bit about the extent to which Ibertas may or may not be a Great One. And so shortly after having recorded that episode, I had a conversation with JSF about this very subject. And I asked him, do you think that Ibertas is a Great One? And he made some interesting points. So, the first point is that, according to the game mechanics, she is in fact kin, but she's the only quote-unquote Great One who is classified as such. So that is to say that when you use a weapon that has a damage bonus modifier, or, you know, bolt paper, for example, I believe has a damage bonus modifier when used against kin, when you use a weapon of that sort, it does additional damage to Ibertas. And in terms of the other bosses in the game, who are seemingly Great Ones, every single one of them does not have that same damage bonus, or is not susceptible to that same type of damage. So that is to say, the Orphan, the Wet Nurse, Amygdala, and the Moon Presence are not considered kin by the mechanics. But Ibertas is considered kin, in terms of the mechanics. So that was his first point. But then he also pointed out that we really have no idea how to even define what constitutes a great one. Because they're clearly not a species. Because you look at all the different types of great ones we fight in the game, they're all very, very different. And he went on to say that it just seems to be a designation given to quote-unquote advanced beings. But also that the item descriptions refer to Ibritas as a great one. And that is true in both English and Japanese. So that led me to think, it led me to reconsider a few things. First and foremost, on the notion of great ones as being a species, to what extent that is something that is feasible or even plausible given everything that we've just discussed. And it seems to me that, yeah, there's really no way that you can make that argument just because of how different they all are. Consider, for example, the moon presence versus Ibritas, or the moon presence is just completely different than, you know, the other beings in the game that are ostensibly great ones. And so that led me to, I guess, the supposition that great ones, to be a great one, is to be of a certain type of species. So that is not a species itself, but a certain type of species. Also, to be of a certain class. I think class is very important in this, because, you know, you are an advanced being. And again, this is something that I brought up in an earlier episode, but maybe this is something that I should have had ready. I should have had the quote ready for this context, and that is part of the idea that Miyazaki was inspired to go with the whole idea of the great ones, every great one losing its child, and that's something we'll talk about in a minute, but about every great one losing its child is that it's rooted in this notion that people of a certain class or people in a rich country versus a poor country are less likely, the birth rates are lower. You're less likely to have children if you have a high-paying job, and you're less likely to have children if you live in a rich country versus a poor country. So, I don't want to say that it's only about class, and it's really hard to even talk about class relative to the great ones because they're so otherworldly. But it seems to me that Ibritas, insofar as she is a great one, and I want to be clear that I don't think that there is necessarily a very clear line separating kin from great one. Because kin is, by its very nature, referring to very close blood ties. And there are very varying definitions of kin, of what kin means and what it constitutes. But I don't think it's as clear as perhaps I've made it out to be, that there's a clear binary distinction between Great One and kin. I think that the lines separating those two are much muddier than I've hitherto led on. So there's that. But yeah, I think that you can look at Great Ones as, you know, beings that are of a sufficiently high enough class, insofar as you can apply that label, but also that, you know, they're of a certain type of species that is advanced enough to qualify for the label. And so something else that I got thinking about is I decided to revisit Redgrave's The Pale-Blood Hunt, the link to which is in the description for pretty much every episode, but if you look in the description for this one, you'll find it there as well. And I wanted to see what remind myself of what Redgrave had to say about Ibritas, because I know that Ibritas, or at least I know that Redgrave doesn't see Rom as being a great one, and that Ibritas is rather contentious herself. But with that said, this isn't all that Redgrave has to say about Ibritas in The Pale-Blood Hunt, but these excerpts are the parts that I found most relevant for our current purposes. Seek Paleblood to transcend the hunt. The first note that the player receives. Many, many players have noticed that there are certain enemies which bleed not red, but a clear and almost pale colored blood. However, this is not the specific pale blood. If this indeed was the blood of the Great Ones, there would be a few figures whom we would believe to bleed pale, but in fact bleed a dark red themselves. Amygdala, the Orphan, the Wet Nurse, and the Moon Presence. There are, however, certain figures which bleed what I call serum. Celestials, Brainsuckers, Master Willem, Rom, and Ibertas. Rom, an ascended mortal, does bleed red if the hunter attacks her stomach, as do her spider kin. But if the hunter attacks the eyes and heads of Rom or her progeny, they bleed the serum of the kin. Serum is not blood of the Great Ones, but rather blood of the kin of the cosmos, those who were once mortal but ascended to becoming kin of the Great Ones. Notice how Ibertas is mentioned as being the daughter of the cosmos, but this does not follow, as every Great One loses its child. Instead, the Great Ones yearn for surrogates. So that is an excellent, excellent point. That every Great One loses its child, so it does not follow, if indeed that is a universal rule of the Bloodborne universe, and not just, you know, a saying that is occasionally true. But if it is a rule that every Great One loses its child, then it's logically impossible for Ibertas, daughter of the cosmos, to be the child of another Great One. So that's very, very interesting. Redgrave goes on to say that Ibertas was possibly Thumerian. Or, pardon me, Ibertas was possibly Thumerian, as she is found by the scholars in a Thumerian city. It is well documented that the Thumerians' research and experimentation with the Old Blood led to their ascension as they neared the Eldritch Truth. However, they were struck down before they could truly ascend to being Great Ones. The Scourge of Beasts spread throughout the people, the Blood Moon rose, the Great Ones descended, and a womb was left with a child. Yharnam's pregnancy with Murgo was a failure, and so in search of a surrogate, Ibertas, possibly a researcher of Tumeru, ascended to the level of the Great Ones. It is so very interesting to me how Ibertas is repeatedly referred to as having been left behind. Ibertas is not a true Great One. Instead, she was ascended to becoming kin, just as Willem did. The Thumerians are ancient. Who knows how long it took her to develop into her current form? Perhaps in 1,000 years, Master Willem will look much like her as well. She was abandoned as the Great Ones left after the devastation of Tumeru, and so she waited in the labyrinth caring for the phantasms, small slug-like creatures which are named as being familiars of the Great Ones. And when the scholars stumbled upon her in Iss, she would finally have an outlet with which to commune with the outside world. So before I continue, I also want to point out, I should have pointed this out at the outset, that these excerpts that I'm reading are in the part of a chapter of the Pale Blood Hunt. At the end of every chapter, Redgrave very clearly delineates the parts in which he's speculating, and so this is Redgrave's speculation. So to some degree, it is based on the evidence of the game, but there is also some filling in of the gaps that's going on here. So I want to be clear that Redgrave is actually pretty clear about that. So Redgrave goes on to conclude on this matter, that Willem and the scholars met with Ibertas, and through her, they began their research on the Old Blood, the tainted blood of Ibertas, surrogate child of the cosmos. It was through Ibertas's tainted blood that the tragedy which struck Tumeru would be doomed to repeat itself in the city of Yharnam. Ibertas seems to get her name from the Ibertas butterfly, a species of butterfly found in South America, which matches the, although admittedly distorted, form of Ibertas as having an almost butterfly-like appearance. When we meet her, she is found in front of a corpse, the corpse of a vacuous spider. Remember that even though something may die in the waking world, its consciousness can continue to survive in the dreamlands. Ibertas had lost her daughter, Rom. It's a tragedy, really. Every Great One loses its child. But there were many surrogates to be found in the baby carriages of Yharnam. So, That's one very distinct possibility, that this is Ibertas's child. And so something that Redgrave pointed out when he was first on the show with me, when we went to Bergenworth and the Moonside Lake, is that Rom doesn't really look like a spider at all. Rom looks more like a caterpillar. And so if Ibertas is a butterfly, then, you know, it would seem to follow that out of Rom, when Rom matures, Rom would hatch into an Ibertas-like ascended kin, who is somewhere near being a great one, not necessarily a great one, but could just be a great one. Because recall also that Rom drops Kin Coldblood. Kin Coldblood, Coldblood of Inhuman, Kin of the Cosmos, Brethren of the Great Ones, used to gain unspeakable blood echoes. Dare not to delve into the world beyond humanity, the Eldritch Truth touched upon long ago at Bergenworth. So on another one of my builds, I do actually have a Great One, Coldblood. And so if you've not spent a lot of time in the high depth, or low depth, I should say, Chalice Dungeons, then you may not know, but there is in fact a Great One, Coldblood, in the game. So I will have to have a look at my other build to see what the item description says for that. But if Rom were a Great One proper, you would think that Rom would have dropped Kin Coldblood. Great One Coldblood, but Rom does in fact drop Kin Coldblood. So I mentioned that was one possibility. There are, of course, many, many possibilities. But another possibility, and one that I had come to like a fair bit, but that I'm not sure how valid it is, considering many, many different things. But I do like the idea of Rom being the caterpillar that out of that cocoon that Rom carries on its back hatches Ibertas. And so recall that we argued in that episode that the Moonside Lake is part of the Dreamlands. And recall also that, as Redgrave pointed out in that first excerpt, that a being can die in the real world in the same way that Mikolash does and persist, their consciousness can persist in the Dreamlands. So if the Moonside Lake is part of the Dreamlands, then it's entirely possible that this is the real world Rom that we're looking at here. And that out of the Rom, the Rom cocoon, I guess, hatched Ibertas. That this is Rom, but in the real world, after it had hatched out of its initial form. So that's another possibility. And there are many, many additional possibilities on top of that, but that's the one I like the most. But at this point, I'm feeling like that's not that's not the most plausible explanation. And it's very interesting to note that, yeah, Ibertas is not at all hostile to us until we attack her and force her to be. Great is Chalice, a chalice that breaks a labyrinth seal. Great chalices unlock deeper reaches of the labyrinth. The Great is Chalice became the cornerstone of the choir, the elite delegation of the Healing Church. It was also the first Great Chalice brought back to the surface since the time of Bergenworth, and allowed the choir to have audience with Ibertas. So that prompt there is something that we're going to have to come back and deal with later on. But, yeah. That's the Altar of Despair. And so something that I mentioned in the live stream that I was talking about earlier, and I don't believe I ever even really got to the point I wanted to make, and that is that it's entirely possible that all of these statues served as the inspiration for the statues that we find all across Yharnam. And I can't really tell in terms of whether this architecture is distinct. But even if it is the same, you could make the argument that these pillars and whatnot, that they use that as inspiration for much of the architecture in Yharnam. But based on the timeline, I don't think that would really work. But the statues could very well. That could very well be the case. Because these seem to have been here for so long that, again, I can't tell if it's just that the textures are really low quality, or if perhaps they're meant to have eroded over a long period of time. Because they're severely lacking in detail compared to their counterparts in the rest of the game. Oh, wow. Another thing I noticed that I hadn't noticed previously about Ibertas during that boss fight is that surrounding that around her, and I can't recall the exact term for this, because in the previous episode we were talking about, in the context of the make contact gesture, about the Voyager 1 and 2 and Pioneer 10 and 11 spacecraft, that all four of them are leaving the solar system. And, yeah, I can't remember the term for it this very moment, but surrounding Ibertas throughout the boss fight seemed to be that very same... So on the edges of the solar system, it's basically just a giant sphere. If you were to exit the solar system and go far enough outside of it, you would see just billions of tiny, tiny little meteorites, or at least they would look tiny from that perspective, surrounding the solar system, kind of covering it, encased in what seems like a sphere, but really what that is the edge of the sun's gravitational influence. So if you're exiting the solar system, you would have to go through what is essentially a debris field, and it looked like that was the very thing that was surrounding Rom. So I'll see if I can find a good image or video that I can put on the screen alongside what I saw while fighting Rom, but that's very much what it looked like to me. So that's very, very interesting. So before we got to the comments, I wanted to talk a little bit about a post that Blackhawk Rogue Ninja drew my attention to that he made on Reddit. And what Blackhawk Rogue Ninja actually posted over, I believe, a series of a week or so was there were a series of threads that he posted containing a lot of insight with respect to, yeah, several different parts of the game. So Unfortunately, just given you know, the time constraints, it won't be able to go over everything. So I would highly recommend that everyone goes and checks it out for themselves, because yeah, there are several different posts, and they given it very interesting and very very intriguing perspective on several of the different mechanics in the game, and you know, how everything fits together with the lore. So I would encourage you to check that out, the links to which will be in the video description. The post that we're going to look at, only a part of this post, but it's called "I Think I Finally Get It: How Runes Work, What the Threat of Light Is, What's Wrong with Being a Vileblood, and How the Universe of Bloodborne Actually Works." We're looking at this one in part because it contains what I think is the most plausible explanation as to how runes work that I have seen up to this point, anywhere in the community. So I did want to draw very specific attention to that aspect of it. So Blackhawk Road Ninja writes, "What are runes? They are a symbolic representation of your desire, your will, and specifically how you want to change slash evolve. We'll get a little deeper into this later when I give an explanation of each rune, but to illustrate the point, here's an obvious example. The strongest eye rune is dropped by Willem. I think it's actually the level 2, but the point remains. His desire is imprinted on and embodied in his blood echoes. So when we kill him, we absorb his souls. We learn that Willem desired more than anything, and dedicated his life to, is discovery. To learn about the true nature of the cosmos. You equip the eye rune and your discovery increases." Pretty straightforward, right? We've seen this type of thing before in Souls games, a character's loot being indicative of their intentions and desires. Question 2, why don't the runes take effect upon you finding them? What does it really mean to memorize a rune? The rune's power will not take effect until you have endured enough pain in the pursuit of desired change. You need the will to endure the pain, then the change will take effect. It has to be earned. Aegon drew my attention to the references to Catholicism, Catholicism, and also the fact that the memory slash rune altar is covered in blood. When you look at the rune tool, it's shaped like a brand, and is actually meant and is actually shaped like the hunter's mark. This, coupled with the fact that the word rune actually means to speak and to cut. In Lithuanian, runoti means both to cut with a knife and to speak. I believe there is a good lore reason why the power of the runes doesn't take effect upon you discovering the symbol, which anyone of above average or anyone of average intelligence could simply memorize. When you pick up the Clockwise Metamorphosis rune in the Forbidden Woods, your health bar doesn't instantly gain a 5% increase. You need to, quote-unquote, equip it. I believe the cutting self-harming that takes place at the rune altar is a reference to a religious self-flagellation. You must prove your will to change is strong enough by enduring the pain of cutting the rune into yourself. Only then will the change occur. Your will to change is then carried by your blood echoes, changing our nature, giving you the new ability. A key point is that Carol runes are described as transcriptions of the inhuman utterings of the Great Ones. So why have I stated that they are your desires? Well, essentially the reason is that when you imbibe the old blood, you are in commune with the Great Ones. And they are sympathetic, don't forget. So when you kill Willem and absorb his blood echoes, they are Great Ones whispering to you a way in which you can change, should you so desire it. They want you to imbibe blood and suggest to you ways in which you could ascend, evolve, change. This is the Great Ones incentivizing the acquisition of blood echoes. So as for the Great Ones specifically incentivizing the blood echoes, I think it's a very interesting idea. But what I think is most exceptionally brilliant about this way of articulating it is that mechanically it is the best explanation I've seen or heard of with respect to the Carol runes. Because recall that, as JSF points out in one of his Bloodborne Up Close videos, I apologize, I can't recall specifically which one, but blood echoes in Japanese, the original text, is essentially dying wish of the blood. So the echoes of blood really do maintain their connection to their original owner. So when you kill Willem and you pick up the eye rune, it really is, as Blackhawk Rogue Ninja puts it, that we are absorbing not only the power that comes along with those blood echoes, but what those blood echoes desire, what the person to whom they originally belonged, what it desires. And that, I think, is just brilliant, absolutely brilliant. And the whole aspect of self-flagellation and how you have to equip it by proving your will to change is strong enough, I think that is also very compelling as well. So again, I would encourage you all to go check out the entirety of that post, because there's lots of really amazing insights like that, and it didn't even get through the entirety of the runes section, but I wanted to give you all that, just an idea of the types of insight that are contained therein. So make sure you go to the video description and check those out. Next, we have a comment from Dezo Penguin, who writes, "You know, I think at some point we as players need to stop with the X is not a true great one theories. I can at least sort of get around the idea of ROM, because nothing in the game itself, only the trophy, states that she is one. So that there is wiggle room, I guess you could call it. But with Ibertas, and for that matter Amygdala as well, I know you don't get into this, but I've seen other discussions on the point. The closest thing Bloodborne has to an objective narrator, the item descriptions, flatly tells us that these entities are great ones without hemming, hawing, or dancing around the point. The game even doubles down on Ibertas with the Augur of Ibertas item also going there. It seems to me then the flaw lies not in our stars, but in ourselves, as it were. That when we start parsing these definitions, that what needs to be done is that we need to look at the concept of Great One in our minds and rewrite that definition in order to fit the facts, rather than twisting the facts to fit our preconceived notions. You allude to this yourself when you discuss it. The fundamental problem with Ibertas, and for that matter ROM, is the assumption that kin doesn't equal Great One. That is, when we see a creature with the attributes of kin in in-game system terms, we see that as evidence dismissing it as being a great one. Instead, I think we need to think of kin as being more akin to a kind of bloodline within the overall spectrum of cosmic entities, one that descends from Ibertas, and perhaps even from Urden, depending on what one thinks about the connection between these two, and which includes entities that are not great ones, such as the Brainsuckers and Small Celestial Emissaries and Living Failures, but also reaches up the scale. I would compare to the Cthulhu mythos, where the lines between elder gods, outer gods, great old ones, and similar entities are blurred at best, and the relationship between them shifting and contradictory, especially when multiple authors are concerned. I may be influenced here by the fact that the mythos fandom has largely rejected the excessive systemization attempted to be placed on the mythos by August Derleth and his immediate followers, but I really do think that kin, in terms of game effects, bolt and thrust weakness, being harmed by kin hunter blood gems, is not so rigid a concept as certain theorists would have us believe. I would further compare it to the fact that while, like kin, beast is a specific flag in the game system, but our concept of beasthood from a lore perspective extends beyond it. For example, the common Yharnamite huntsmen are scourge victims, as are, I think, but can't be 100% sure, the beast patients in Old Yharnam, but are not beasts from a system standpoint. I'm not sure if that's true. I don't believe that that's true, but I think that your point still stands nevertheless. And of course, Great One is not a system flag at all. So again, on that last point, I don't think, I'm reasonably certain that those enemies are in fact weak to the serrated damage type, but I could be wrong about that. And if I'm wrong about that, then that is very interesting. Certainly, if any of them were to not be affected by the beasthood, the serrated damage type, the beasthood damage bonus, then it would be the huntsmen, because you know they still speak as though they're humans, and they call us beasts. But I would imagine very much that the beast patients would still be included among that group. But that is an interesting point, and just in general. I don't really have all that much to add to what Dezo Penguin has said, because it seems pretty airtight to me. There's really nothing I can say that would add or contradict really anything that Dezo Penguin has said here. So thank you for a very thoughtful comment, and very well-written one at that, too. Jambobok786 did reply to Dezo Penguin, writing, "I understand what you were saying and agree with a lot of your points. I don't think the exact same source of each Great One's origin is important in understanding their function in the story, but I do think you shouldn't assume that text narration is objective. Item descriptions like the Tearstone state things that are proven false by in-game mechanics, and items like the Wooden Shield break the fourth wall and address the player character's playstyle. If the narrator is somewhat unreliable, it would make sense that Kenner referred to as great ones, as the human observers in Yharnam would be unable to tell the difference. Again, I agree that we really can't fuss over the taxonomy of great ones, but I did take issue with your assertion that the narration is objective. So I think, even though I don't disagree with anything that Dezo Penguin wrote, I do think that this is also a good point, and a well-made one at that as well, in that I'm not entirely comfortable with saying that the item descriptions constitute an objective narrative voice, as Jabobach has pointed out. That what Dezo Penguin said wasn't that it was an objective voice, but that it was the closest thing we have to an objective voice. Or specifically what he said is that, yeah, it's the closest thing Bloodborne has to an objective narrator. So I again, can't disagree with that, because he didn't actually say that they were objective, just that it's the closest thing. And I think that that's an accurate point. So, but still a well-made point, nevertheless, Jabobach. Andrew, who also goes by the name Hypnotic, writes, I've seen you mention a few times about level geometry. This video regarding the positioning of Ibertas relative to the walkway in Upper Cathedral. I made maps of Bloodborne which reflect walkable areas. As far as I can tell, everything in Upper Cathedral and regular Cathedral Ward fits together relatively well. So Hypnotic, first I wanted to thank you for making this map, because not only is it cool, but I'm sure it's helped at least a few players, and it's really well done as well, so thank you for doing that. And thank you for sharing it with us. It's very interesting, but I don't think that a two-dimensional top-down map, as great as this is, I don't think that that could necessarily capture the type of thing that I was talking about. So this is something that JSF brings up in his comment, where he says, speaking of geography, have you noticed that the clock tower, as seen from the outside, doesn't match the version where we fight the Living Failures and Maria? It's not just a nightmare thing, because the clock tower models in the nightmare are incorrect in the same way. The area where Lumenwood Gardens is too narrow to accommodate the garden we fight in, and crossing from one side to the other leads you to an area above the clock face, not within it. So the clock seems to have gone through multiple iterations, as with the position of Old Yharnam. So in three-dimensional space, some of these things are easier to fudge, I think, than they are otherwise when you're looking at a top-down two-dimensional map. And in the Upper Cathedral Ward, I'm not 100% sure if that reflects the same thing, but there is often a lot of weird fudging going on in the Souls games to give that appearance that things are actually connected in a sensible and non-changing way. But your point stands nevertheless, Hypnotic, and I appreciate it, and I appreciate you for making that map for what I presume to be for free for the community, which is great. JSF also writes, the beggar in his beast form dies by yelling, hunters are killers, nothing less. So if he's wearing that gear as a disguise, that is the Herald set, then he probably isn't a hunter anymore and has turned his back on it. I also just noticed the symmetry of the locations, with the Healing Church on the ground level, the choir above them, and the School of Mensis below them. And speaking of cut content, Upper Cathedral Ward has smoke coming out of the chimneys, but we never see what's burning. Maybe they're cremating bodies of failed experiments or something. That's very interesting. JSF also writes, the creatures depicted by the shrouded statues aren't shrouded. The shroud isn't part of the physical sculpture itself, it's a piece of cloth that has been draped over it and tied around the base, that I did not know. The color and texture are different from the stone, and you can see where it's affixed to the base using ropes, so it looks like the choir were intentionally covering them up. It could be iconoclasm, but I'm not sure what the purpose would be. Maybe they were just transporting them through Cathedral Ward and didn't want to arouse suspicion. I think we need to look at where make contact is, not just the gesture. It's on a balcony from which you can clearly see the night sky, and this balcony is divided into a number of viewing windows. If you make contact with an object in the sky as night fell, you'd be able to describe its position in the sky as it moved from horizon to horizon, assuming you held the gesture for like 8 hours and moved very slowly. So it looks like this might be a kind of psychic observatory, where the choir could focus on a stellar object and attempt to make contact. Now the moon is in the rightmost window of the balcony when we get there, which lines up with the corpse's right arm as it makes the gesture. Given the significance of the moon, that might have been where what they were tracking. as to why are the creepy statues here. I think we mentioned this before, but it might have been cut out of the final edit. There are extra statues in the Lumen Flower Gardens that aren't there in the Nightmare version. So if the Nightmare is the past, then someone's been moving in new statues into the area. Perhaps that's why they're covered in cloth. I always assumed the Emissary was summoning Celestials from Iss in the same way a Bell Maiden summons things from other worlds. The Emissary itself is hugely confusing because it's found in the non-root version of Iss, where you also find Ibertas. Since the Choir explicitly found Ibertas in Iss, it makes sense that they'd find the Emissary there too, except that it drops the Communion Rune, which suggests it was made artificially using blood ministration, and an edit unless it's the source of the Communion blood that's turning people into Celestials. Another point against Ibertas being a proper great one, if those slug babies are hers, then they should drop third cords because they'd be infant great ones, unless they're filled offspring. The fourth master writes, "What you said about the lantern attacks and insight brings to mind something from one of Vatividia's videos, explaining what he called plot insight, where regardless of your insight stat, your character still has a sort of invisible insight stat based on plot events. For example, if you have less than 15 insight, the mad ones in Hemwick will not spawn, but after killing Amelia and touching the skull, you earn enough plot insight to always see the mad ones no matter what. As to why the enemies don't just kill you with something else, something you can't see, a what you can't see can't hurt you kind of mentality is present in many of Lovecraft's works, and the game may be drawing on that for this gameplay mechanic." So the idea of plot insight I think is interesting, but something that I will have to test is whether or not this applies in general. So I've not tested the Hemwick thing, so I'll have to test that and see what actually comes up, because if that's true, that's interesting. It's certainly true that after you defeat Rom and you reveal the Nightmare Ritual, that you can see the amygdala, the lesser amygdala, all over the place, the false gods, as the guide calls them, whereas previously you couldn't. And that similarly, that same, you know, quote unquote plot insight, or you know, you've advanced to a certain stage of the game insight, that, you know, you can't avoid having that inherent insight, irrespective of how many you actually have. That you would think would apply to the church servants in the lower, or in just the cathedral ward proper, but I don't believe it does. So I'm going to have to check that out and see, because if that, like, I don't doubt that that's true, like, that makes sense, because you can't go to the upper cathedral ward until you've reached that point. So, you know, we couldn't go there earlier to see whether or not they still, because they wouldn't have programmed it to actually have that distinction in there. But it's very interesting, but if it's true that it's applied inconsistently, then that would be kind of disappointing as well. So we'll see. I suppose I'll, if I have the time, I'll cut it in on the screen now, and you'll see whether or not at in the late game with less than 15 insight that you will see those special attacks from the church servants or not in the proper cathedral ward. DeLawrence Perkins writes, "Aegon, the make contact gesture is called the Pythagorean right triangle proposal. Shows extraterrestrials visibly that we know mathematics. I always found the gesture extremely interesting, with the idea of mathematics serving as a literal universal language, and serve as a starting point of deciphering other alien dialects should we come across them." And Dima Parachute writes in reply, "The gesture is not actually complete. The triangle represents an area. The triangle is later inverted through motion. Thus, it becomes exposed to time. Time over area is used to calculate flux, roughly, or represent the motion of matter through space. So it's more than a simple gesture. It's a way to manipulate time and space, or becoming susceptible to manipulation of time and space. While we appear stationary, we are actually moving through space and time. In the grand scheme of things, is probably a way to tell us that even if it seems that events, be they positive or negative, appear as though they repeat themselves. In reality, everything's in motion as we travel through space and time of the universe, and same events take place in different times and space. There is some kind of proverb out there that goes along the lines of repetition is the mother of knowledge. That's why people say that doing the same thing over and over again is the definition of insanity. It's because you actually gain knowledge, and having too much knowledge might drive someone insane. So I think that everything Dima Parachute wrote there is very insightful, but I did want to point out that the definition, that's not actually the definition of insanity. And also, because it's I know that you didn't do this, Dima Parachute, but that's often attributed to Albert Einstein, but that's not actually something that Albert Einstein said. So just because that's one of those sayings that I often hear, and I just wanted to be clear about that. Mr. Bonus writes, I think the statues with staves depict celestial emissaries, going by the general shape, head, and fingers. They carry the messages of the cosmos, so I think they would be deserving of some worship. I love how the boss makes some radio/interference sounds, like once his tentacles come out. They are antennae. He's getting a signal. Yeah, we talked about that previously in the To the Discovery of Kinship episode. Could the name of the orphanage be a reference to Ibertas? I've always read people thinking that it's called that way because they use orphans to create emissaries, and although I think humans can be made into them, as seen in the clinic, I think the ones here are literally being grown like plants. If the choir was born from the orphanage, wouldn't it be reasonable that it's called so for Ibertas, daughter of the cosmos, and left behind old one, or left behind great one? She could count as an orphan, I guess. I think that it could be that, it could be that it's a double meaning, but certainly either one is definitely plausible in my view. About kin weakness and Ibertas, I think that kin, because of their closeness to the great ones, share their weakness. At least from a game mechanic sense. Saying that Ibertas is closer to kin than Great One based on this alone seems like a bad point. For instance, doesn't the Orphan of Kos share the same weakness? And we are sure he is no kin. So to clarify, Mr. Bonus, as we pointed out earlier, the Orphan is not susceptible to that damage type. Ibertas is the only ostensible Great One in the game that is susceptible to the kin damage type. Ite001 writes, I apologize for the terseness of my original comment, and that the point of view that a person succumbing to the beast, the scourge of the beast, means they ended up exhibiting beasthood. Personally, I feel FromSoft's descriptions are often vague in design, and that we must latch on to any truth we find within due to Occam's razor, thus my original conclusion. However, I do wish to bring to light your own commentary of Yhargul, and that as you get closer to the One Reborn's boss room, that the music gains volume because the School of Mensis is trying to beckon, call a Great One into being, or to beckon a nightmare. And we'll get into that when we go to Yhargul, the difference between those two things and what's actually happening. I would extend that philosophy to Upper Cathedral Ward and say that Ibertas is singing to his children, as though the violins we hear are Ibertas's words, and the more humanly melodic notes are the choir conversing in kind. To summarize, I believe that to some extent, that we are hearing Ibertas' words, and that is what attracts the celestial children, but our beastly idiocy makes us think it is only musical notes. So I really like this idea that the music we're hearing in the Upper Cathedral Ward and in the orphanage is Ibertas herself, but Ibertas is now dead, and I'm still hearing the music. So, you know, maybe you can make the case that it's her singing from beyond, but, you know, using the Yhargul example, where we already have a precedent in the game for when the thing stops happening, when the source of that music is gone, then you no longer hear the music. So if it weren't for that, I'd say that might be plausible, but for whatever reason, we still hear it. And I say for whatever reason, but I assume the reason is that Ibertas isn't actually the source of the singing. So I'm very sorry that I could not address more comments, and that I couldn't address the comments that I did in greater detail. But yeah, as I mentioned, I've been sick lately, and I'm just starting to get a little bit better, so I didn't want to push myself too hard at this point. But I did want to get another episode out before, again, I start falling behind with Dark Souls 3 so close upon us. So thank you all very much for joining me, and I will see you in the next one. Bye-bye.